Good morning. Good to see everybody. I'm glad to see Dickie. I mean, he made it. I know he's probably even in pain. I hope not, but we're glad you're here. Mad at success. You ever seen anybody that would get mad at their success? Jonah, the son of Amittai, and prophet of God, he was from a town about 2 miles northeast of Nazareth. Jonah is commanded by God to go to a heathen nation to preach to the city of Nineveh, the capital of Assyria. The Assyrian Empire was a threat to Israel. They were enemies of Israel. Jonah is unwilling to go. Instead, he wants them to be destroyed. God is willing to have mercy on everyone who seeks Him. And their repentance that they're going to do postponed their destruction for 150 years until 612 B.C. when the Assyrians were conquered by the Medes and the Babylonians. Some people reject the book of Jonah. Some people dare to do that because of the great fish that swallowed Jonah. But listen, God is able, that's nothing to God, is it? God is able to do anything that He wants to. He created this universe. He caused the sun to stop in its path. He divided the Red Sea, and on we could go. He created you and I. Jesus knew the book was true. He knew that book was true. And He knew Jonah was true. Matthew chapter 12, beginning at verse 40. Matthew chapter 12, beginning at verse 40. Just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the sea monster, he says, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will stand up with this generation at the judgment and will condemn it because they repented at the preaching of Jonah. Behold, something greater than Jonah is here. And that's Jesus Christ our Savior and the salvation that He offers. Nineveh is first mentioned in Genesis chapter 10 and verse 11. It was an ancient city. It was founded by Nimrod. The book of Nahum in chapters 2 and 3 predict the destruction of Nineveh. Zephaniah gives a picture of the city in ruins in Zephaniah chapter 2 and verse 13. He will stretch out His hand against the north and destroy Assyria. He will make Nineveh desolation, parched like the wilderness. Zephaniah, he'll continue on talking about that in the rest of the chapter. Jonah means dove, dove. We have great lessons that we learn from the book of Jonah. We see an attitude and prejudice that come forth that we're not to have as Christians. God was not pleased with Jonah. He was told to go preach to the city so they would repent of their evil ways. And first Jonah said no. Can you believe that? Jonah said no. But God taught him a valuable lesson that we can learn. Let's look at Jonah chapter 1, beginning at verse 1. Jonah chapter 1, beginning at verse 1. The word came to Jonah of the son of Amittai, saying, arise and go to Nineveh, the great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah rose up to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. So he went down to Joppa, found a ship which was going to Tarshish, and paid the fare, and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. When God told Noah He wanted Jonah, when God told Jonah that He wanted him to go to Nineveh and preach, he rose up, and what did he do? He headed in the opposite direction. He didn't want to go there. He's trying to run away from God. He doesn't want to obey Almighty God. He's going to go in the total opposite direction. So he goes to Joppa on the seacoast, and he gets as far away as possible. He gets his ship going to Tarshish, and he doesn't care. He just wants to leave. He doesn't care. He doesn't want to obey Almighty God. So he goes to Joppa on the sea coast, and he's trying to get away as far as possible. So Jonah, he did not misunderstand God. There's no way that he misunderstood God. God's words were clear. God's words were easy to understand. Jonah just doesn't want to go there. It's a huge heathen city. It's the capital of Assyria. And Jonah's going to have to answer to God. And God will get his attention real quick. Jonah was faithful to God. He was faithful to God in his life and as a prophet. But I tell you what, he's the only prophet. The only prophet to try to run away from God. Just unbelievable. He does not want to obey God, and there's two reasons. He hates them as enemies, Nineveh. They were enemies of Israel, and his hatred made him prejudiced. He wants them to be destroyed. He wants them to be wiped off the map. They're not saved. And Jonah is determined. He doesn't want them to obey God. Jonah finds out he can't hide from God. That's the first thing we learn. Jonah can't hide from God. In chapter 1, verses 4 through 15, Jonah boards the ship to run away from God. God brought a great wind on the sea, and the storm is so bad that the ship is about to break up. It's about to be destroyed. It's about to sink. And the men on the ship trying everything they can. They're trying to lighten their load, but that doesn't work. All during this, believe it or not, Jonah is in the bottom of the ship and he has fell asleep. Verse 6. So that the captain approached him and said, "How is it that you are sleeping?" And in my words, he would say, "What's wrong with you?" That's what we'd say. "Get up and call on your God. Perhaps your God will be concerned about us so that we will not perish." He tells him to call on his God for help. In verse 7, the sailors can't figure it out either, why it's so dangerous and what's happened from a calm sea. And so they start to cast lots to find out whose fault this is. And the lots fall on Jonah. And now they see that he's responsible for all this. So the men go to Jonah and they ask Jonah four questions in verse 8 and 9. "What's your occupation? Where do you come from? What is your country? What people are you?" Jonah tells them the truth. "I'm a Hebrew. I fear the Lord God," in verse 9. "I fear the Lord God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." Jonah told him he was running from God in verse 10. Then the men became extremely frightened and they said, "How could you do this?" For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord because he told them. He told them that. So the men asked him, "How could you do this?" So they asked, "What should we do with you? How are we going to fix this problem? What would we do with you?" In verse 11. In verse 12, Jonah says, "Throw me into the sea." Jonah'd rather die than obey God. I want you to see how many times Jonah says, "I want to die." This is the first one. "Throw me into the sea." Jonah tells him, "Throw me into the sea. I'd rather die than obey God, that he may and he may know that the storm's going to stop when they throw him into the sea." I don't know. Here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking to myself, the men prayed to God. They prayed, "Do not let this blood be on us. We're going to chunk him overboard, but don't let his blood be on us." And that's in verse 14. But they don't want to throw him overboard. They don't want to do that. They think more of Jonah than he thinks of himself. They couldn't get the ship to the land. They tried everything that they could possibly think of. They don't want to throw him into the sea. And the men finally came to the realization there's no other choice. And so they threw him into the sea in verse 15. And just as soon as they threw him into the sea, the storm stopped. You know what the sailors did? They made sacrifice. They made sacrifice and they made vows to God. Verse 16. God saves Jonah by preparing this great fish. Verse 17. And the fish swallowed Jonah. And he spent the next 3 days and three nights in the stomach of that fish. I often wondered, how long it took him to figure out where he was. I don't know. What do you think? I wonder if he thought to himself, where in the world am I? I've got this weeds all over my head. I can breathe. I know I'm alive. I wonder how long it took. And I wonder if he's thinking to himself, what in the world am I going to do? So Jonah prays to God. I want you to look at that prayer. In Jonah chapter 2, beginning at verse 1, I want you to look at his prayer. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the stomach of the fish. And he said, I called out of my distress to the Lord, and he answered me. I cried for help from the depth of Sheol, and you heard my voice. For you had cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the current engulfed me. All your breakers and billows passed over me. So I said, I have been expelled from your sight. Nevertheless, I will look forward to your holy temple. Water encompassed me to the point of death. The great deep engulfed me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. I descended to the roots of the mountains. The earth with its bars was around me forever. But you have brought me up, my life from the pit, O Lord my God. While I was fainting away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you into your holy temple. Those who regard vain idols forsake their faithfulness, but I sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving. That which I have vowed, I will pay. Salvation is of the Lord. God got his attention, didn't he? He got his attention. We see Jonah, he repented. He's ready to go to Nineveh now. Oh, I'm ready. I'm good to go. God commanded this great fish to throw him up on the shore. He's a long way from Nineveh. I mean, it is a long way from Jerusalem or Nazareth to Nineveh. We don't know how long it took him to get there. And we don't know how long he was underwater in the belly of that fish. Did he go north and to the coastline and throw him up there? I don't know. God, that's God's business. And so they threw the fish threw him up on the shore. God got his attention, and he's ready to go. Now watch how long it took. The city is so big, and he preached his heart out at Nineveh. And the city is so big, it took him 3 days to walk it. He preaches one day, he preaches another day, and he preaches the third day. It took 3 days to preach to that city. And he tells the people to repent and turn from their evil ways, or God is going to destroy the city in 40 days. Well, we know the results. Chapter 3, beginning at verse 5. Then the people of Nineveh believed God. And they called a fast and put on sackcloth, from the greatest to the least of them. When the word reached the king of Nineveh, he arose from his throne and laid aside his robe from him and covered himself with sackcloth and sat on ashes. He issued a proclamation and said, in Nineveh, by the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let a man, beast, herd, or flock taste a thing. Do not let them eat or drink water. Both man and beast must be covered with sackcloth. sackcloth, and let them call on God earnestly, that each may turn from his wicked way and from the violence which is in his hands. Who knows, God may turn and relent and withdraw from his burning anger so that we will not perish. You see, Jonah, you see what happened as a result of his preaching. You can see the results. The king and the people believed in God. Verse 5, they called for a fast. They put on sackcloth. Sackcloth is a dark, coarse material that's worn. It's a sign of mourning, a sign of repentance, and that's what they're all in. The king of Nineveh laid aside his king's robes in verse 6. He clothed himself in sackcloth, and he sat on ashes. And then he issued the proclamation in verse 7 and 8. He called for a fast, no food, no water. Everyone was to wear sackcloth, even the animals. And he called on God that they did, and they turned away from their wickedness. Verse 10, when God saw their deeds, that they turned from their wicked way, then God relented concerning the calamity which he had declared, and he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. You ever wondered why we pray so hard for our country? Every prayer today has prayed for our country, hadn't it? That's why, just like that, just like Nineveh. Now in chapter 4, we see Jonah's reaction. Chapter 4 began at verse 1. But it greatly displeased Jonah. Do you hear that? You see that? It greatly displeased Jonah. And he became angry and he prayed to the Lord. He said, please, Lord, was not this what I said while I was still in my own country? Therefore, in order to forestall this, I fled to Tarshish, for I knew that you would be gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, and one who relents concerning a calamity. Therefore, now, O Lord, here goes number 2, please take my life from me. Can you believe that? For death is better than me than life. And the Lord said, do you have a good reason to be angry? Jonah, instead of being happy, he's mad in verse 1. He praised God that God had compassion, that he was slow to anger, that he was abundant in loving kindness, and he did not destroy Nineveh. But now look at Jonah's very next words in verse 3. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for death is better to me than life. He's asking God to take his life. That's how much he hates Nineveh. That's how much he hates that they repented and turned to God. What an amazing thing he's accomplished. He's preached for 3 days. He's preached the truth of God's word and converted an entire city. Now listen, of 120,000 people. That's preaching, isn't it? He hates this so bad. He hates this heathen city so much that he didn't want them converted. He wants them destroyed. Jonah would rather die than see, and we see his prejudice. He'd rather die. Jonah was throwing a temper tantrum. How many temper tantrums do we throw? He has decided they don't deserve to be spared, regardless of what God wants. He decided. How many times have we decided what God should do? Chapter 4, verse 5 through 8. Jonah goes out of the city, and look what he does. He sits down. He made a shelter away from the sun, and he wanted to see in verse 5 what would happen. What's he want to see? He wants to see the city of Nineveh completely destroyed, to go up in smoke like Sodom and Gomorrah. We think to ourselves, well, how could he do this? It's terrible. This is to show us how determined this man was. He's wanting to get his will, not God's will. God is going to teach him by making a plant. God sent a scorching east wind. He makes this plant to shade him in verse 6. And then in verse 7, he sends an attack on the plant by a worm. And the sun in verse 8 beats down on his head. Again, Jonah begged to die. That's number 3 or 4. I can't remember. I can't remember how many I counted. In chapter 4, verse 9 through 11, God asked Jonah in verse 9, "Do you have a good reason to be angry at the plant?" And Jonah said, "I have a good reason to be angry to even to death." There's another one. It's a good thing God is long-suffering, isn't it? Can you imagine how patient God is, especially with Jonah and us? Can you imagine? I'm so thankful he's long-suffering with us. Verse 10 and 11. God said, "You had compassion on the plant for which you did not work and which you did not cause to grow, which came up overnight and perished overnight. Should I not have compassion on Nineveh, the great city? There are more than 120,000 persons who do not know the difference between their right hand and their left hand, as well as many animals." All of these people needed God too. You know, it's not recorded for us. It's the end of the chapter. It's not recorded for us what Jonah's further response was. But you know what I think? This is just old Timbo. I think that he got to thinking about all this. Maybe what God had told him and tried to teach him. And maybe he repented. Hopefully he did. What can we learn? What can we apply to our life, the book of Jonah? How can we apply this book to our life? What are some things that we learn? The first and obvious one is we cannot run from God. Jonah could not run from God. You and I can't run from God, nor can we hide. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 through 14. I want you to look at that. "For the word of God is living and active, and sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing as far as the division of the soul and the spirit, of both the joints and the marrow, able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are laid open and bare to the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession." Jonah's disobedience, like our sin, we learn affects others, doesn't it? Our sin affects others. Most likely, we've heard people say, "You know, my sin, that's nobody's business but mine." You ever had somebody say that to you? "Hey, that's a sin, I know that, but that's not your business. That's nobody's business but mine." You know what? That's never true. Never true. Jonah's own business was running from God. And he put all those other men on the boat in danger. And the truth is, our sin will harm the ones we love the most. So it is with others in business that think it's their business when they sin. No, it's not. I'm telling you, sin affects the others that we love, that we're closest to. The things we do, the life we live, the choices we make. Drugs, alcohol, on and on you could go. It affects loved ones in every generation, and it always will. So Jonah, his business was running from God. It's others' business when we sin. Jonah thinks he's safe in the bottom of a boat. He thinks he's getting away from God. Again, we learn here, our sin will find us out. Our sin, I'm going to say it again, will find us out. And Adam and Eve sinned in Genesis 3 and verse 10. Adam and Eve thought they could hide from God. Nothing in this life can hide from God. Nothing that we do can hide from God. He knows all things. He sees all things. He knows our hearts. He knows our thoughts. Men on the ship asked Jonah, who was his God. But in the process of rejecting him, by his actions, he's demonstrating to the sailors that his life is not right with God. And we do, there's not a dime's worth of difference when we don't live as a Christian and the community sees us. It's the very same thing, that our life is not right with God. Today, some claim to worship God, but instead their lives don't show it. It's really plain to see that they're running away from God. Sailors didn't want to throw Jonah overboard. The sailors thought more of Jonah's life than Jonah did. Then Jonah even thought about a city full of 120,000 people. We see his hatred. We see his prejudice coming out. May we never, you and I, ever have this kind of attitude. God had a great fish swallow Jonah. And while he's in the stomach of that fish, he had time to think, didn't he? He had time to think. He prayed to God, "I call out of my distress to the Lord, and He answered me," chapter 2 and verse 2. He says, "The great deep has engulfed me. Weeds are around His head." And in verse 9 of chapter 2, He says, "I will sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving. That which I have vowed, I will pay. Salvation is of the Lord." Now he's got his head on straight. How long does it take us sometime to get our head on straight? How long does it take us sometime to realize we're out of focus with God? How long sometimes does it take to see our own hearts and say we're not right with God? Sometimes when trials come in our life, we have to stop and realize and think that God created us, and realize that He loves us and He will see us through any problem. That He's always with us. But we have to obey Him. We have to walk with Him, or we're going to face the consequences of an eternity. God has a plan and a purpose for Jonah. Even though Jonah rebelled, God didn't give up on him. Listen, I am so thankful that God doesn't give up on us. That He has a plan for each one of us. And we don't give up. And He doesn't give up on us. Jonah went from self-righteous attitude to thinking that he knew better than God. Humble to humble and prayerful and obedient servant. We must obey God and His Word in our life. And we have to seek to do His will today. Once Jonah is delivered by God from that fish, his preaching converted an entire city of 120,000 people. And they turned from their evil ways and they were spared. For 150 years, they were spared. The Word of God changes people, changes lives, changes our lives. Today we have to be dedicated to tell others of the hope that we have within us and proclaim the whole counsel of God. Jonah did what God commanded him to do. But God had to be patient with him as he saw Jonah change his direction. But he didn't change his mind, did he? Did he change his mind? No, he didn't. He still hated Nineveh. He still wanted the city destroyed. He wanted to sit on that hill in the heat and watch that place go up in smoke. He did what God commanded, but he did the very least he could. Is that the way we are? Just do the very least, and that's it. Jonah, from his self-righteous attitude, thinking he knew better than God, to becoming humble, prayerful, obedient to God, but he didn't change his attitude. The Word of God changes people. It should. It changes our hearts. It changes our lives. Jonah didn't change his mind. He's mad. His hatred showed here. He waits to see if God's going to destroy the city. Do we ever act like Jonah? Do we teach others? Let me ask this. Do we teach others and think to ourselves that they will never change? It's no use. Or even worse, deep down, we hope they don't respond. Because we say to ourselves, they won't change their life. It's no use. You know what that is? That's God's business if they change their life. It's our business to teach. We plant the seed, but God's responsible for the harvest. It's not our business to think to ourselves, they're never going to change. His Word changes lives, and we're never to forget that. We must have concern for all lost souls. All of us must. Jonah's reply to God is not recorded at the end of the chapter, but I hope and pray that he got the point, that he saw his foolishness, he saw his attitude, he saw his actions. Many times in our lives, we get all out of focus and all out of whack. And what's really important, instead, to do God's will, we focus on concerned, worthless stuff and things, and neglect serving God in our life. As Christians, we're to keep our attitude from not getting in the way of God's plan. Because sometimes it does. Sin in our life can blind us from doing God's will. In our life, we have to be an example of faithfulness. When we read, or when we are a bad example in our life, it reflects. You know who it reflects on? It reflects on Jesus Christ. It reflects on His church. When our life, we get carried away and get out of focus and out of duty, we need to repent and be thankful to God for saving us and live for Him. Throughout the book of Jonah, we see the call and the need for repentance. It applies to every one of us here as well. Look at Luke 11 again. Luke 11, beginning at verse 32. I'm going to read the whole thing. I'm going to read 11, 32 to 36. A while ago, I just read part of this. Luke 11, beginning at verse 32. The men of Nineveh will stand up with this generation at the judgment and condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah. Behold, something greater than Jonah is here. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it away in a cellar, nor under a basket, but on a lampstand, so that those who enter may see the light. The eye is the lamp of the body. And when your eye is clear, your whole body, he says, is also full of light. But when it is bad, your body is full of darkness. Then watch out that the light in you is not darkness. Therefore, your whole body is full of light with no dark part in it. It will be wholly illuminated, as when the lamp illuminates you with rays. We got the point, don't we? The Lord has a way of making his point. Have you obeyed God in your life? Have you obeyed God in your life by being a Christian? To do so by believing in him and repenting of your sins and confessing that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and being baptized for the remission of your sins or the forgiveness of your sins, and then be a faithful child of God. You'll be that faithful child of God, a Christian. All of God's promises will be yours, and then you'll live faithful the rest of your life and have a home in heaven for an eternity. You can be a Christian today. Too many in this world reject him. There may be some here that reject him for the rest of your life. Reject being repenting. Too proud. Reject being baptized for the forgiveness of your sins because you think it, your plan is better. This plan of God's is simple and it's plain and it's easy to understand as it can possibly be. But many, like Jonah, they run away from this command. Many think they have a better plan, but God doesn't. He doesn't think you're that way. He doesn't think your plan is worth a hoot. It's only his plan. If you're a Christian, have you thought about your attitude every day? Have you thought about your actions? Is your attitude and your actions pleasing to God? Are you faithful in your life? Or have you been an example that you should be in your life each and every day? Or have you been doing like Jonah? Running away from God. If your heart is not right as a Christian, you need to repent. You need to make it right. We can help in any way. I'm so glad to see y'all. I thank you for being here. If we can help in any way, won't you come while we stand and sing?